I try to be a better person, you know. I'm trying not to lie as much as I used to. I used to lie all the time for some reason. And, you know, now I'm trying not to, you know, because, you know, sometimes there's a reason for your lies. You know, like you want to protect somebody's feelings or, you know, screw over your buddy Larry or something like that. But do you ever just lie for no reason at all, folks? You know, just all of a sudden, a big lie will spill out of your evil head there. And you don't even know why, you know, like, you know, a guy will come up and go, hey, you ever see that movie with Meryl Streep and the horse? And then you go, yes. And then in the back of your head, what the hell am I lying about over here? I stand to gain nothing by this lie.
Good morning. It's Monday, Medal of Honor Monday, April the 29th, and this is The True Conservative. Welcome to all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers out there. I'm Ron, your host, and the only true conservative in the United States today. So today, after the Serenity Prayer and the Patriotic Song of the Day, we will have the Patriotic Shorts, Motivation, Bishop Barron, Ayn Rand, the 33 Strategies of War, and the Medal of Honor. All that and more when I get back. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I should not change, the courage to change the things I should, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen.
Again to the producers for giving me my Bowie fix this morning as we look down Sixth Avenue towards Central Park. Beautiful morning. Going to be warm in the city today. Actually, the streets are reasonably busy. Never like it used to be, but anyway, let's move on. Good morning, everyone. It's 10 o'clock Eastern. I'm Ashley Webster, in today for Stuart Varney. And, of course, let's get straight to your money. As you can see, the Dow, the S&P and the NASDAQ all moving just ever so modestly higher by about 0.25% across the board. Let's take a look at the 10-year Treasury, which was moving lower as we started the session. That is the story. Down a couple of basis points at 4.64%. Oil, too, has been moving just a tad lower. Let's take a look. Yep, down 0.5% at $83.43 a barrel. And Bitcoin, well, let's round it up. Also moving lower, I believe, down almost $2,000 at $62,011 for Bitcoin. All right, now this. RFK Jr. says Americans are, quote, voting out of fear as he responds to why he's behind in a three-way race. What?
Thank you, and now, guns.
And let's see if we can react and shoot five. Five on target.
in a second. Target in the middle. Here we go. I got a little bit excited. I actually fired 6 rounds. Let's go ahead and count back. I'm a revolver shooter by trade, so I work in numbers of 6 at a time. So that was 5 rounds and a 108. Not quite what I was shooting for, but not a bad warm-up run. Let's go down range and take a look at the paper right quick and see what we're doing. That was 6 rounds. Like I said, I'm a revolver jockey. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. They're all in the A box, a little bit low. So what I have to do as a shooter is remember that that scope is actually looking here, but the rounds are going to be about the center of that board, which is about 2-inch difference. So I'm going to tidy this up a little bit, see if I can crank out 5 in under a second with the reaction time. And that's what's going to be important. With reaction time, 5 shots on target. One of the things good about this timer, I can go back and look at my performance. So what I'm looking at, my first shot was a .55. That's a little bit sluggish. But the actual split times in between shots was really good. So we had a 14, a 12, a 13, a 14, and a 10. So all I need to do to make this time happen is to really get off that timer and jump in the center of mass a little bit quicker. A 55 is kind of slow at this range. So I'm going to listen really good for that timer, get in the center and punch out 5, see if we can make it under a second. Here we go. Now, that was a little bit better. You saw how I was punching out right on the timer there. Let's take a look at it. A .96. Made it that time pretty easy, so. All right, 96, we had a 15, a 12, a 13, a 12. So we're running good splits. We made the time pretty easy. Let's go back and look at that again. Total time of .96 hundredths. Let's go down range, take a look at it. Okay, guys, we're a little over 5 yards here. I punched out 5 rounds in .96 hundredths of a second. Let's take a look at them. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. I got a little bit excited here on the last one. I started raising my head up. So, but they're all in the A box. They're all right center. Center of the A box. But I know you're not happy with that. I'm not either. We're going to make it a little bit harder. We're going to go ahead and put 3 in the A and 2 in the head and try to keep it in under a second. So I'm going to react 3 in the body, 2 in the head, in under a second.
How come it's legal for the government to do this, but it's not legal for a citizen acting in self-defense? For a police officer, is something that is referred to as a tool or drill or 21-foot rule. As if I'm standing 21 feet from a potential threat, and let's say he has an edge weapon or a club, if he rushes me, by the time I can get my gun out and fire a shot, he will have stabbed me about the same time. It means it's a tie. This is why police officers are trained that people with clubs and knives are danger to them at greater than 20 feet. The prosecution mindset typically is the farther someone is away from you, the less threatened you should be. So therefore, if someone's 10 feet away, you shouldn't have fired your gun in self-defense. Now, my theory is, if it's justifiable for a police officer to shoot a threat at 20, 21 feet, it is just as justifiable for your client acting in self-defense to do the same thing.
This guy went in and shot up a school. What's your solution? Hey, all of you that didn't go in and shoot up a school, hand over your guns, because that's going to deter this guy. And I'm looking at this going, wait a second, guns have been around in massive quantities in the United States for hundreds of years. It used to be that during hunting season, boys would show up with their shotguns in the truck on school so they could immediately get out to the fields as soon as school was over. Yet we didn't have this problem. Why are school shootings like this a recent phenomenon in American history? Gun ownership is not a recent phenomenon. Schools are not a recent phenomenon. So why is it different now? I think there's two things you have to look at. One is, how do you address the immediate problem? Well, I don't think you address the immediate problem by telling a bunch of people that did nothing wrong that they have to give up essential civil liberties. I think you address it by having more security in the places which have become vulnerable targets. And this is the part that they really don't want to talk about.
Nick Freitas put this very well. They try to rely on us not having a memory or not talking to our grandparents to see how it was back in the old days. You could say there was even more of a gun culture back in the old days. Kids used to bring their guns to school to go hunting afterwards and didn't see any of the stuff that we see now. Why is that? They don't want to talk about it.
We have a grizzly bear head today. It is full of green blood, and this thing weighs 75 pounds. It's absolutely massive. And today, we're going to do some bear protection tests. This is a Smith & Wesson 460 Magnum ES, which stands for Emergency Survival. These actually came in bear kits, which has a 2 3/4-inch barrel. As you can imagine, she be kicking. Underwood ammo, 360 grain hard cast. Golly! I hit it right in the mouth. I don't know if Yogi Bear is going to be wanting any more picnic baskets after that one. This is a good example of just how tough a bear would actually be. These bones are tough, but not as tough as an actual bear. And that did not make it all the way through this thing.
Do you know why AK mags are orange? It's not just about visibility or tactical advantage. Initially crafted from AG4 or Bakelite, which was orange in nature, these magazines were chosen for durability, cost effectiveness, and weight reduction. As the Soviet Union developed into plastic experimentation for their firearms, Bakelite emerged as the front runner due to its exceptional preservation of desirable properties. However, the transition from yellow to orange and later to brown wasn't solely a deliberate color choice. It was influenced by storage conditions in Soviet warehouses. Contrary to common beliefs about their brittleness, Bakelite magazines proved to be durable thanks to fiber reinforcements in the resin used during their production.
Adaptability is the advantage. Introducing the Smith & Wesson Response 9mm Carbine. This PCC rifle is lightweight and adaptable, embodying the best combination of function and form. With our interchangeable FlexMag adapter system, the Smith & Wesson Response allows you to customize your shooting experience like never before. The Smith & Wesson Response can be adapted to use a variety of popular 9mm double-stack pistol magazines, making it the perfect companion to your existing handgun. Compatible with popular charging handles, grips, stocks, and trigger groups for AR-style rifles, perfect for customizing to your needs. Embrace adaptability with the Smith & Wesson Response.
And that was Guns. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now, the Patriotic Shorts.
The A-10 Thunderbolt II, affectionately known as the Warthog, is exceptional. It has earned its reputation as a formidable support aircraft. The A-10 is built to withstand more damage than any other frame. Its pilot is surrounded by multiple titanium armor plates, allowing it to endure small arms fire and continue flying its attack missions. Unlike agile and nimble planes, the A-10 is deliberate, hefty, and impactful. There's nothing flimsy or fragile about its construction or flight characteristics. The A-10 is designed with redundancy. If one hydraulic system fails, another kicks in. Even if all electronics, digital displays, and targeting systems are lost, an A-10 pilot can still fly, drop bombs, and operate the 30mm cannon. Unlike other aircraft, the A-10's gun alignment is straight along the fuselage line, making it ideal for air-to-ground attacks.
Initially, Hitler did incredibly well. I mean, his blitzkrieg, incredible. If he had stopped with the Anschluss, where he gets Austria and he's going to take Czechoslovakia, and then he says, I'm uniting the German people. If he had quit right there, he would have gotten away with it and probably be considered a brilliant leader by Germans. But then hubris, right? The blitzkrieg worked so well, his generals told him he couldn't do it, but of course it worked. And then he goes further and overextends, etc. When you look at what you think are great generals on the Western side, they are great generals. But their success has to do with a whole lot of other people. Think about it. If we hadn't broken the codes, which is the British helped us do that, and the Poles who brought out various Enigma machines and other things, would it have turned out the same? If you don't have Henry Ford, who's turning his cars into tanks, and the people who built Liberty ships, would it have been the same? If you do not have scientists doing the Manhattan Project, would it have been the same? And think about the enormous mobilization with the United States, where Americans are all on board, and in Britain and all over. We tend to personify it as the general. It ain't so. It's everybody.
Russia recruited two men to attack U.S. military bases in Germany. In Germany, arresting the two on suspicion of plotting sabotage, where they allegedly planned to bomb American military facilities, including the base where Americans train Ukrainians on Abrams tanks. And now, a man's been arrested for aiding Russia in a plot to kill Zelensky, with a Polish citizen allegedly working with Russian intelligence in order to assist in his assassination. Also, Russian hackers are suspected of cyber-attacking a Texas water facility, causing a tank to overflow back in January. And that all allegedly a part of a Russian campaign to intimidate Western citizens away from supporting Ukraine.
Did you know in the movie Top Gun Maverick, there's a scene where Maverick and Rooster are shot down behind enemy lines and steal an enemy fighter plane to get back? This is actually loosely taken from a real-life incident from World War II involving Colonel Bruce Ward Carr, a highly decorated American Air Force pilot who found himself in a similar situation during the war. In November 1944, Colonel Carr got shot down over Germany, and he evaded capture for several days. Then, in a move straight out of an action movie, he managed to sneak into a Luftwaffe airfield, steal an enemy plane, and fly it all the way back to the Allied lines when Colonel Carr finally made it back to his home field in France. The landing gear on the stolen plane wouldn't come down, so he had to make a risky belly-up landing. The armed personnel at the airfield mistook him for a hostile German pilot. It wasn't until his group commander recognized him that they realized he was one of their own.
There is a person riding on the tail of this aircraft, but not by choice. As early as the 1910s, when battleships were launching seaplanes so they could observe and correct the firing range of their guns, you had to be very careful where you sit so you don't end up flying while holding on for dear life. Even once aircraft carriers had become a crucial part of the U.S. Navy, unsuccessful landings easily highlighted the importance of following safety protocols on the flight deck. Sometimes a napalm bomb would be left behind after takeoff, and other times the aircraft would come to a stop, but the mess hall wouldn't. Even to this day, you sometimes see the personnel do things that look kinda questionable, which makes you wonder, where are the safety guys? Oh, there they are, just enjoying the view.
Did you know in the film The Great Escape, the director subtly portrays some German soldiers differently from the typical Nazi representation? For instance, Werner the Ferret disapproves of Nazi practices, but acknowledges that he cannot openly complain about them. Similarly, Colonel von Luger is seen wearing a medal that was issued before the rise of the Nazi regime, and when given instructions by the Gestapo and SS, he treats them as recommendations rather than strict orders. His reaction to the execution of the 50 escapees reveals his personal horror. Additional, more understated details are woven throughout the narrative, such as the possibility that he released prisoners Hiltz and Ives from solitary confinement earlier than the 20 days he had initially sentenced them to, and his decision not to interrupt the American prisoners' 4th of July celebrations.
Heil Hitler.
Heil Hitler.
Heil Hitler. Heil Hitler.
The one thing that our transportation was that we had a regimental commander named Lynch, Colonel Lynch, and they called it the bug out, and everything was going on trucks in the back end of them that was carrying ammunition, artillery rounds, because they were pulling the guns in back of the truck and all the dust was flying up in the truck and everything. And whenever we got to some place where they had ground action, somebody picking off and shooting at us, we'd peel out of the truck and go and take care of that problem, and then come back and get on the truck and we'd go on.
The instructors are looking for more than physical grit. They are evaluating candidates for integrity, honor, selflessness, and teamwork. Candidates must push through the pain to prove themselves worthy of continuing.
Down.
From the beach, candidates run back to base for a long, cold swim into Coronado Bay. As the temperatures drop and the rain pours down, they must show their instructors they're willing to push through adversity to accomplish the task at hand.
Swicks operate in the water, in the ocean, a very unforgiving environment. We put them through evolution after evolution in the water. We stress their bodies to their limits. This helps them understand how to stay calm and work in this environment.
He enlisted in the newly formed Army Air Force shortly after his 18th birthday. He became a B-17 waist gunner for the 381st Bombardment Group. His name was Francis Owens, but everyone called him Bud. It was July 4th, 1943, and their B-17 was crippled en route to the target in France. The pilot made the decision for the crew to evacuate. Seeing the radio operator badly wounded, Owens gave him his parachute, ejected him from the plane, and pulled the cord. As for Bud, he found an extra parachute and jumped. He met up with members of the French resistance, and they orchestrated an escape through the Pyrenees Mountains to Spain. The arduous 750-mile journey through the cold mountains was too much for the weakened Owens, and he died of exposure, lost to history. In 1951, his remains were identified, giving closure to his family. Bud Owens is buried at the Ardennes American Cemetery in Belgium.
Thank you, thank you. Now a little bit of motivation.
Again and again and again, the lights are cut off, but you're still looking at your dream, reviewing it every day and saying to yourself, it's not over until I win. There are moments when you're going to doubt yourself. There are rough times that are going to come, but they have not come to stay. They have come to pass. It's very important for you to know that. Don't say I'm having a bad day. Say I'm having a character building day. No matter how bad it is or how bad it gets, I'm going to make it. It's possible that you can live your dream, that it's necessary, that you're relentless, that you have a plan of action, that you are creative. Not over until I win. I'm the one. No matter how bad it is or how bad it gets, I'm going to make it. The people that are running after their dreams are the people that are hungry. Don't stop running toward your dream. Don't stop.
Your time is limited. Don't waste it living someone else's life. Don't be trapped by dogma, which is living with the results of other people's thinking. Don't let the noise of others' opinions drown out your own inner voice. And most important, have the courage to follow your heart and intuition. They somehow already know what you truly want to become. Everything else is secondary.
Your life is your life. Know it while you have it. There is a light somewhere. It may not be much light, but it beats the darkness. Your life is your life. Don't let it be clubbed into dank submission.
Someone's opinion of you does not have to become your reality.
People who can't see it for themselves can't see it for you.
You have greatness within you. You are an uncommon breed. You have to know within yourself that I can do this. Even if no one else sees it for me, I must see it for myself. If you want a thing bad enough, work day and night for it. Give up your time and your sleep for it. Sweat for it and fret for it and plan for it. Only go after that thing with all of your capacity, strength and sagacity, faith, hope, and confidence, and stern pertinacity. I'm the one. I'm the one. No matter how bad it is or how bad it gets, I'm going to make it. If life knocks you down, try and land on your back. Because if you can look up, you can get up. You want it, and you're going to go all out to have it. It's not going to be easy. When you want to change, it's not easy. If it were in fact easy, everybody would do it. But if you're serious, you'll go all out. I've got a lot going for me. I got some good stuff in me. I can bounce back from adversity and reinvent my life. It's possible. Regardless of where I am, but things can get better for me. I'm coming back, and I'll be stronger and better because of it. You have got to make a declaration that this is what you stand for. You're standing up for your dreams. You're standing up for peace of mind. You're standing up for health. You want it. You'll go all out to have it. You got to find ways to increase your sense of self-appreciation, because if you don't, you're bombarded with negative stuff every day that beats you down, and you will find yourself unconsciously engaged in self-destructive behavior. If you don't program yourself, life will program you. Take full responsibility for your life. Accept where you are. And the responsibility that you're going to take yourself where you want to go.
If you are going to try, go all the way. Despite rejection and the worst odds, it will be better than anything else you can imagine. If you're going to try, go all the way. There is no other feeling like that. Do it. Do it. Do it. All the way. All the way.
Persevere, I think, is important for everybody. Don't give up. Don't give in. There's always an answer to everything.
And that was a little bit of motivation. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now, the Daily Dad for April the 29th.
April 29th. How long can you go?
Kind people are never involved in arguments, and those who like to argue are never kind. Lao Tzu.
At the end of it, you'll wish you fought less with your kids. You wish you made less of an issue. So many things. Nobody looks back on their lives or their kids' lives and thinks, I'm so glad we got into all those arguments. I'm glad I was so hard on them. I'm glad they finally learned all the rules. You know this. Okay, so today, how long can you go? How long can you go without chiding your kids about this or that, without making remarks about your teenager's choices, without reminding your young one to stop dragging their feet leaning on the table? Leaving their things laying about. See if you can make the majority of your interactions uncritical. That doesn't mean you have to be disingenuously positive about them, only that you stop bothering them about so much piddly crap. None of that stuff matters now, as much as you might try to convince them and yourself otherwise. It definitely won't matter years from now when you're all reflecting on your lives together. So dial back the criticism. Remember, you don't have to have an opinion about everything. If you can keep some of that stuff in your back pocket, you'll both be happier for it.
And that was the Daily Dad for April 29th. How long can you go? And unfortunately, he's wrong about this. It does make a difference. No, you're not going to sit back and reflect on that. Of course not. You're going to find other things to talk about, your vacations and whatnot. But what will make a difference, and you will know what makes a difference, is when you see your child as an adult. When you tell them, keep your elbows off the table and stand up straight and eat your vegetables and all the things that this guy is claiming is petty and small and nonsense, and they grow up to be fine, upstanding adults, then you'll know that it was worth it. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now, Bishop Robert Barron.
Everything around me, whatever exists, is already the gift of God. That's what creation means. God is the one who brought the whole of finitude into being. This world is not just dumbly there. It's there as a result of God's initiative, of God's grace. More to it, everything in me. So I'm seeking God with my mind and my will and my passions and so on. Well, where did my mind and will and passions come from? It's not like I just happen to have them and now God's out there and boy, I'm going to make my way to impress God. No, no, I'm the contrary. My mind, my will, my energy, my passion, everything in me is always already the gift of God.
And that was Bishop Robert Barron. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now the Ayn Rand thought of the day. Quote, the brute facts of a mixed economy are gang rule, i.e. a scramble for power by various pressure groups without any moral or political principles, without any program, direction, purpose, or long-range goal, with the tacit belief in rule by force as their only common denominator and, unless the trend is changed, a fascist state as the ultimate result. Unquote. And that was the Ayn Rand thought of the day. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. So if you're a Democrat, you need to vote Republican because the Democrats don't care about their constituents, but the Republicans do. The evidence of that is in the House of Representatives, where the Democrats all act in unison, unified. You never hear them talking about or against other members of their caucus. Everybody's unified. They're all marching in lockstep, whereas the Republicans have a tendency to bicker and whatnot. That's because the Republicans know that it's the House of Representatives, and the Democrats think it's the House of Democrats and Republicans, and they think they're there to represent their party and not necessarily their constituents. So again, if you want to be represented, you need to quit the Democrat Party and vote Republican. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. Now we pick up where we left off with the 33 strategies of war.
Interpretation. Throughout the 20th century, many artists wielded influence by being unconventional. The Dadaists, the Surrealists, Pablo Picasso, Salvador Dali, the list is long. But of all of them, it is Marcel Duchamp who has probably had the greatest impact on modern art. And what he calls his ready-mades are perhaps the most influential of all his works. The ready-mades are everyday objects, sometimes exactly as they were made, a snow shovel, a bottle rack, sometimes slightly altered, the urinal laid on its back, the mustache and goatee drawn on a reproduction of the Mona Lisa, chosen by the artist and then placed in a gallery or museum. Duchamp was giving the ideas of art priority over its images. His ready-mades, banal and uninteresting in themselves, inspired all kinds of associations, questions, and interpretations. A urinal may be a seedy commonplace, but to present it as art was utterly unconventional and stirred up angry, irritating, delirious ideas. Understand, in war, politics, and culture, what is unconventional, whether it is Hannibal's elephants and oxen or Duchamp's urinal, is never material, or rather, it is never just material. The unconventional can only arise out of the mind. Something surprises is not what we expected. We usually base our expectations on familiar conventions, clichés, habits of seeing, the ordinary. Many artists, writers, and other producers of culture seem to believe at the height of unconventionality to create images, texts, and other works that are merely weird, startling, or shocking in some way. These works may generate a momentary splash, but they have none of the power of the unconventional and extraordinary, because they have no context to rub against. They do not work against our expectations. No more than strange, they quickly fade from memory.
And that was the 33 Strategies of War, and he was wrong about the Duchamp. Duchamp was not making a statement about art at all. He was using art to make a statement or a critique of property and property rights. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now here's a World War II veteran who wanted to re-enlist for the Iraq War.
When Iraq War started, when the Desert Storm, I was walking down the street. I went by an Air Force recruiting office, and I walked in, and I walked up, and I said, "I do." And the guy looked at me, and he said, "I'm sorry." He said, "But you're going to have to get a facelift before I can take you." I said, "You dirty." But anyway, I really was serious. I would have gone back in a minute. And I would have stayed in the service longer than I did, but I had two boys, and they were getting of age, so I had to have them back home and be back there with them, because they were just starting to get of an age, and I was worried about them. So that's the reason I got out. I've been involved with the military as much as I could be ever since. I just love the military and the people in it. I think we've got the best.
So the interesting thing about this conversation is how he said he left. He would have stayed in longer, but it was his children that forced him to get out and go home. And that's not true. What he should have said was, I had two small children at home. I knew that the best thing for me to do was to get out of the service, go home, and raise my children. That's the way he should have said it. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now, the Medal of Honor.
The Medal of Honor citation for First Lieutenant Vernon Joseph Baker is as follows. For conspicuous gallantry and intrepidity at the risk of his life above and beyond the call of duty, First Lieutenant Vernon J. Baker distinguished himself by extraordinary heroism in action on the 5th and 6th of April, 1945. At 0500 hours on the 5th of April, 1945, Lieutenant Baker advanced at the head of his weapons platoon, along with Company C's three rifle platoons, towards their objective, Castle Aganolfi, a German mountain strong point on the high ground just east of the coastal highway and about 2 miles from the 370th Infantry Regiment's line of departure. Moving more rapidly than the rest of the company, Lieutenant Baker and about 25 men reached the south side of a draw some 250 yards from the castle within 2 hours. In reconnoitering for a suitable position to set up a machine gun, Lieutenant Baker observed two cylindrical objects pointing out of a slit in a mount at the edge of a hill. Crawling up and under the opening, he stuck his M1 into the slit and emptied the clip, killing the observation post's two occupants. Moving to another position in the same area, Lieutenant Baker stumbled upon a well-camouflaged machine gun nest, the crew of which was eating breakfast. He shot and killed both enemy soldiers. After Captain John F. Runyon, Company C's commander, joined the group, a German soldier appeared from the draw and hurled a grenade which failed to explode. Lieutenant Baker shot the enemy soldier twice as he tried to flee. Lieutenant Baker then went down into the draw alone. There he blasted open the concealed entrance of another dugout with a hand grenade, shot one German soldier who emerged after the explosion, tossed another grenade into the dugout, and entered firing his submachine gun, killing two more Germans. As Lieutenant Baker climbed back out of the draw, enemy machine gun and mortar fire began to inflict heavy casualties among the group of 25 soldiers, killing or wounding about two-thirds of them. When expected reinforcements did not arrive, Captain Runyon ordered a withdrawal in two groups. Lieutenant Baker volunteered to cover the withdrawal of the first group, which consisted mostly of walking wounded, and to remain to assist in the evacuation of the more seriously wounded. During the second group's withdrawal, Lieutenant Baker, supported by covering fire from one of his platoon members, destroyed two machine gun positions, previously bypassed during the assault, with hand grenades. In all, Lieutenant Baker accounted for 9 enemy dead soldiers, elimination of 3 machine gun positions, an observation post, and a dugout. On the following night, Lieutenant Baker voluntarily led a battalion advance through enemy minefields and heavy fire toward the division objective. Lieutenant Baker's fighting spirit and daring leadership were an inspiration to his men and exemplify the highest traditions of the military service.
And that was the Medal of Honor. Back in a minute. Thank you. The following is one of my voiceover demos. If you're a voiceover artist and you would like to advertise one of your demos on my podcast, please send an MP3 to thedrill12, all one word, at gmail.com. That's thedrill12 at gmail.com. Back in a minute.
Americans love scenery. We want to see it all, from one coast to the next, Mount Rushmore down to the Everglades. So hop into a Chevy Malibu and take the scenic route. It's the car you knew America could build. There's a place where people count on friendships they can trace back generations, where they can count on the same stool at the coffee shop waiting for them every morning. This place is called Glen Ellen, and you can find it in every bottle of Glen Ellen wine. This is craft brewed Herman Joseph's, the smoothest, easiest drinking specialty beer in the entire solar system. And I believe you'll find drinkable in the dictionary right after don't order a beer you can't drink. Zoingo! Boingo! The freestyle pogo with more boing, more bounce. Bounce further, bounce higher with Zoingo Boingo. To see what makes Arrowhead Mountain Spring water different from those other waters, you have to go back to the source. And with Arrowhead, that means going back a little farther and longer than most. Between security challenged and security strengthened, there's one important word, how. And it is the how that makes all the difference to our nation and our world. Lockheed Martin. We never forget who we're working for. What makes Kraft Singles so good? 2 out of every 3 kids don't get the recommended amount of calcium. But with Kraft Singles, they get a good source of calcium and the taste they love. Kraft Singles. Magic every single time. Throw boring overboard with a new real meal from Long John Silver's. A meal worthy of a plate, just $4.99. Only at Long John Silver's. We may not all be geniuses, but we can all do something smart. Introducing the Hyundai 199 Sonata Lease. It's a smart deal on a really smart car.
Thank you. This is Ron, your host, the only true conservative in the United States today, bidding adios to all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers out there and reminding you that you are not neutral and that the government has no rights.